Hi guys, it's about time now that we start with the wind turbine part in this course. So, as usual, let's start by analyzing the wind turbine model that was already present in the original radial grid and analyze the different components, the different elements, the different common models that are part of this wind turbine. So first of all, the wind turbine element is this gentleman that we find down here. It's an doubly fed induction machine. So it's a type C or type 3 according to the IEC classification. Is of course still the most popular wind turbine that we find installed around the world. The machine size it's 6.25 megawatt, and the generator nominal rating it's a 7 megavolt ampere machine. You see that the voltage here is 20 kilovolt, which to be fair would not exactly be the voltage level of the generator, but that would be the voltage level that you typically have after the step-up transformer that is inside the turbine. 20 kilovolt or 33 kilovolt would be a common voltage values. So that means that in this case, we are not modeling the transformer that is present in the wind turbine. We are just neglecting this element. And that's why our generator is a 20 kilovolt machine. So the machine is, let's say, a standard doubly fed induction machine, 20 kilovolt rating, 7 megavolt ampere, 3 pole pair. So that means that nominal rotational speed is a little bit less than 1000 revolution per minute in the 50 hertz world. And it has a certain characteristic in terms of cage. So it's a double cage machine with these properties that you find here, which are more or less standard values for a doubly fed induction generator. One interesting element is the moment of inertia, which is around 500 kilogram square meter. That normalized on the machine basis corresponds to a little bit less than 1 second of acceleration time. As we will see later, the rest of the wind turbine, so not the electrical generator, but actually the rotor and the blades, account for a little bit more than 7 seconds. So that all in all, the wind turbine is around 8 seconds of acceleration time. But as we will see in the exercise and in the examples, this moment of inertia basically contributes for nothing unless we modify the control loop in order to release or to give the possibility to this to some of this kinetic energy to be utilized for inertia response. So that's about our doubly fed induction machine type and the corresponding element. Also, for this type of machine, as any other kind of generator, we can provide some dispatch values in terms of active and reactive power. We can specify if the voltage should be set or the reactive power should be set. And also in this case, we can characterize a capability curve for this type of machine. So you can see the capability here, which is of course much narrower compared to the one on a conventional synchronous machine. Still, it's able to provide a certain amount of reactive power in the moment that there is a certain amount of active power production. And typically, the larger is the active power production, the larger is the reactive power capability. That could be different according to each individual manufacturer. So typically, according to what the grid code is requiring in each country, then this capability will be made more or less flexible in order to fulfill the grid code requirements. And that's about the static component. Then we have the associated dynamic model, which is, let's say, fairly complex, or at least more complex compared to the one of the conventional machine. But it can be quite well described by analyzing the most important blocks, actually. So the first thing to keep in mind, you find here the composite that is actually characterizing the frame that is actually characterizing the relationship between all block definitions and related common model that are behind each block definition. So we can split the model basically in three sub in three macro area. So the first one, which is the blue one that you find here, it includes the dynamic of the prime mover. So that basically means the turbine itself. So the rotor and the blades, the pitch control system, and so on. And we have four blocks. The first one that characterizes the wind, so the wind speed that is seen, the equivalent wind speed that is seen by the wind turbine. The dynamic of the pitch control system, the turbine, so the aerodynamic characteristic of our wind turbine, and the dynamics of the shaft. So that basically means the mass of the two shafts, the high-speed shaft, the low-speed shaft, the flexibility or the stiffness of the gearbox, and so forth. Out of it, we get the power that is sent to the DFIG, so to the generator itself. And then the remaining part, which is located down here, is actually characterizing two different set of dynamics. So first, there is a series of blocks here, which are used to characterize different dynamics. So the first actually is the MPT, so the maximum power tracking characteristic, which is taking the rotational speed of the generator as an input and simply setting the active power set point that the generator is supposed to, the DFIG generator is supposed to produce according to the rotational speed of the machine. This is quite important because the whole control loop relies on the rotational speed of the machine, not on the wind speed of the machine. Then we have two measurements block down here. One is for voltage and frequency, the other one is for the active and the reactive power. So all these measurements are used for different purposes. So for instance, there is a protection block that is necessary to open the breaker of the machine whenever some grid conditions are not safe for the machine to operate. Typically, very low voltage values. That's one classical situation. After a certain point, the machine is not required to be connected anymore. So this block is making sure that the generator will trip. Another dynamic that this block is characterizing is the triggering of the crowbar. So that big piece of resistor that will bypass the rotor converter and short circuit the rotor cage of the generator into a resistor so that we have an extremely resistive cage, but the machine ends up being like a type A machine. So with a squirrel cage generator and not a controllable generator anymore. We have another couple of blocks here. So the first one is to characterize the reactive power capability. So how much reactive power should the machine produce according to a certain voltage on the grid? And the other one, the block that is emulating the inertial response if we want to provide a certain amount of inertial response. Then we have another series of blocks here in the red frame, which are modeling the two proportional integral control loop that are behind the DQ control of the rotor converter and the grid side converter of the generator. And then the other blocks down here are just measurement block from the rotor currents and also mathematical transformation to get the DQ transformation in the control loop. So that's the overview. Then we can have now actually a detailed analysis of the different blocks. So as usual, we find everything set in the composite model. So you can see here that we have several common model, many more than what we actually have for the conventional machine. So most of them are actually common model, and then there are also a couple of measurement blocks. So that would be just to start from the bottom, that would be just power, active and reactive power measurement at the connection point of the machine, voltage measurement, also at the connection point of the machine, and a PLL, so a phase measurement device, also at the connection point of the machine. So all these are necessary for the converter to perform, for both the converters to perform their control and also to adjust the power production according to grid states, voltage, frequency, and so on and so on. Then what about the other blocks? So we have the wind common model, which is used to characterize wind speed variation throughout the dynamic simulation. Now, this block is fairly simple, but at the same time also quite important. The first important thing to bear in mind is that in this specific model, we never set the initial wind speed explicitly. So the initial wind speed is always calculated backward according to the initial active power set. So what we can specify in this block is actually variation in the wind speed. So we can specify if we want to have a certain amount of wind speed ramp, gusts, and so on. So just to have a look, I mean, you can find here the code that is behind. It is fairly simple DSL code. So we can specify a certain series of ramp that you see here. So additional, so variation in the wind speed, starting at a certain time, finishing at another time, with a certain amplitude and a certain ramping rate, pretty much. So this is what the code is telling us. And you see here, these are the commands that we find in that are used in the Power Factory. And just to remember, you can always click F1 on the individual text, and then you will get the usual manual open, where you find actually what's the meaning of the, what's the syntax, and also what's the meaning of each of these commands. So select, for instance, is doing a selection of one input or another input according to a certain Boolean expression. So coming back, we find here, for instance, that we can specify a wind speed ramp of a certain amplitude, starting at a certain time and finishing at a certain time. And then we can specify others afterward if we want to do that. Another very important aspect is that if we are using this single element to model a single wind turbine, then this wind speed should be the wind speed equivalent for the individual wind turbine. But if we are using the single element to model an equivalent wind farm, then we should be careful that this wind speed profile should be the equivalent wind speed seen by the entire wind farm. So variation in terms of wind speed should take in account that there is a certain displacement between the wind turbines. And of course, the larger is the wind farm, the stronger will this displacement be. So you find here that right now I have just one element, and this element is modeling one individual machine. But I could easily say that this single machine could model 10 wind turbines in parallel. And you see here that the amount of power that is dispatched increased 10 times. So just remind that this machine is a 6.25 megawatt, and actually the minimum initial power that can be set is 0.3 megawatt. The model does not support startup of the machine, so it's not possible to emulate any starting of the machine, so starting from a 0 megawatt and then getting to a low value. So that means that if we want to have the machine up and running in our model, and we want to emulate an increase of power production from the wind turbine, then we should start with a very low value, which could easily represent a situation where we have really no wind power production, and then increase according to the amount of power that we want to get. You see here reported the most common, at least for this course, power set point for the machine. So The 0.3 megawatt would correspond to approximately 5% of the initial power. The 3 megawatt, which would be approximately half of the nominal production, and the 6 megawatt, which would be almost full production. You see that for each initial power, we need to specify inside the dynamic model the initial rotational speed. So I remind you that we don't specify the wind speed, but we specify the rotational speed normalized of the generator. Where do we do that? So the initial power, as you just saw, is a set here in the load flow page of the element, while instead the initial rotational speed is specified in this block that we call speed ref initial. So this block is just including a constant, so it's a value that we need to fill in. And this value should be chosen according to the initial power. If we don't choose it properly, then the model will not initialize correctly. That doesn't mean that Power Factory will give you an error. It will simply mean that you will have a dynamic at the very beginning. And larger is the deviation between the initial set speed and the one that should be set. And of course, the larger will be the deviation in the initial states of our model, which ideally could also lead to instability and computational error. So should be very careful in doing that. Then according to these two values, the wind speed will be derived backwards from the model. So let's move forward. Let's see also the other blocks. So we saw now the wind and we saw now the speed ref initial. What else do we have in the mechanical modeling of the wind turbine? We have the turbine block here, which is specifying basically the aerodynamic characteristic of the machine. So it's, for instance, how large the rotor is, what's the air density that we are at the place that we are located. And quite importantly, which one is the aerodynamic characteristic of the blades seen in terms of CP, so the power coefficient, as a function of the tip speed ratio, which are all these values that you see here in the first column, and according to the pitch of the blades, which are all the columns that you find here. So whenever the machine is not as a pitch equal to zero, which is the optimal pitch for this type of wind turbine, the equivalent CP, so the power coefficient, will be generated according to the second column of values, taking as an input the wind speed and the rotational speed, which will make it possible to calculate the tip speed ratio. And you see here that this value will reach 0.51, which is the top efficiency for this type of blades, with a tip speed ratio that is approximately 10. So just to remind you, we are basically characterizing this characteristic that we also saw previously in the class. So it's just a lookup table including this series of curves. Right, so that's about the turbine. Then we have about the shaft. So the shaft is modeling a two-mass equivalent shaft. So we are modeling the mass of the interaction between the mass of the generator, of the electrical generator, the mass of the blades and the low-speed shaft, and the stiffness and eventually torsional damping of the gearbox. And of course, inertia of the blades. So this would basically characterize this two-mass model representation that we have here in the slides. The pitch control would be the last block for this specific dynamic. So this block is actually modeling the dynamics of the, so the control logic that is behind the activation of the pitch control system, which is a simple, fairly simple proportional integral controller activated according to an error on the speed versus the reference rotational speed. And then it's modeling the dynamics of the actuator. So how quickly the blades can pitch in and pitch out, so how many degrees per second the blades can pitch, and how much the blades can, the pitch angle can go. In this case, it's zero, which is the minimum pitch, up to 70 degrees. So in this case, the pitch control system would basically characterize this kind of dynamics that you find here. That is about the pitch. Then the other blocks, the one that are the mostly interesting blocks, are the MPT control. So the MPT control is the control characteristic. Also in this case, it's a fairly simple lookup table that is setting the normalized active power production. So that's the second column, according to the to the measured rotational speed. So the implementation that this curve is realizing is this characteristic that you find here in the slides. There is the possibility of setting also a cap, so to, let's say, intentionally limit the power production of the machine if we want to limit the output of the generator to a lower value compared to the nominal one. And that would be this P cap value here. So if you keep it to one per unit, that means that we will not cap anything. Just remember that this value is normalized according to the complex power of the machine, so according to the 7 MVA of the machine. Other interesting blocks are the characteristic for the reactive power production. So in this case, it's another lookup table that can provide reactive power set point according to two measurements. So the first measurement is the voltage at the point of common coupling, so at the connection point of the wind turbine, and the other information is the active power produced by the generator. So in this case, we have a characteristic with a dead band in the middle, so you see that between 0.98 and 102, the reactive power will be set to zero. And then according to how much active power the machine is producing, again, per unit on the apparent base of the machine, so on 7 MVA, then the generator will, the controller actually, will set a certain amount of reactive power produced by the machine. And we are basically characterizing this type of behavior. Of course, we will set the control to produce capacitive power when we are in an under voltage situation, and inductive when we are in an over voltage situation. Also, in this case, the characteristic can be changed according to the specific properties of the individual machine. Other blocks that are relevant, it's the DFIG inertial response emulator. So this is one possible implementation of inertial response emulator. It's basically two washout filters. So it's two derivative filters where we can specify the gain and the time constant. And that would be this type of characteristic, this type of dynamic that you find represented in these slides. So we have a certain delay, and then we have a certain derivative response. That's not the only way you can model the DFIG inertial response, but that's probably the most straightforward. Another couple of blocks, and then we can wrap up this video. It's about the protection. So in the protection, we will see this better in a following video when we will take the different exercise. We can specify how the machine will behave according to a certain voltage value in the grid. So specifically, according to a certain voltage measure in the grid for a certain amount of time, the machine will be forced to be to remain connected or to be disconnected from the grid. So right now, it's all a series of thresholds, pretty much, that you find in this characteristic according to voltage and according also to the rotational speed. And right now, the characteristic that is implemented is extremely stiff, is extremely robust because the machine will really stand very low voltages for a very long time. It's not the case. Again, it depends on how strict the requirements of a grid code are. That's about the protection. And then the last block that is relevant analyzing is about the rotor current measurements and the rotor current controller. Actually, there are not really a lot of values to change here because that's just nominal values that are used for the model to calculate the control signal for the DFIG controller. So it's just a series of gains and nominal values that don't need that must not be changed throughout the system. So that's pretty much the overview of the wind turbine. Then in the following videos, we will actually see how we can utilize the model for different type of examples. So that's pretty much it.